magical force in your life.
Hello viewers, you're welcome to another episode of New Testament Voice, your favorite telecast brought to you by the New Testament Christian Mission International. You'll be watching today excerpts from the Family Life Table discussion of Men's Advanced Conference 2016 on the topic Ministering to Your Wife. God has called every man to minister to his wife. In this series, some individual men will be sharing with us how God has helped them to fulfill this call of God upon their own lives. We trust that this will be a blessing to your family. Happy viewing, and God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you. Father, we thank you for this session that we are going into. Lord, we don't want to hear man. We are not here to listen to men. We want to listen to you through men. And that is why we are asking you to take over everyone that will be ministering here tonight in Jesus' name. I pray that your spirit within us will inspire us. That nothing of the flesh will be done here tonight in Jesus' name. Lord, you will remind your children everything you want them to bring to us. You will grant them the grace of communication, that their sharing will bring great blessings to all of us together. And Lord, as you help me to coordinate, it will not be me, it will be you by your Spirit doing it through me in Jesus' name. Thank you, Spirit of the Living God. Because we are not just going to hear what we are going to share as usual, but it will produce changes in our marriages so that we can please you better. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for we have prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. The theme or the topic for our table talk is ministering to our wives. Hallelujah. We are going to read from the book of Colossians chapter 4 verse 17 as the basis for our discussion.
And say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received in the Lord, that thou fulfill it.
And say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received in the Lord, that thou fulfill it. Apostle Paul was writing to the Colossians, and here he spoke about a particular individual. And brethren, this is God's word to everyone that is born again, because all of us have ministry. We are called to minister. And he said, take it to that ministry which you have received of the Lord, that will fulfill it. Now, so many people think ministry is all about preaching and teaching. Ministry is more than preaching and teaching. And if you look at the book of Matthew chapter 20 verse 28, you will see that the Lord Jesus Christ himself told us. He said, the Son of Man came not to be ministered to. But to minister. And the context was when he was discussing with the disciples, as two of the disciples came wanting to take the first places in the kingdom. And you will remember also that in the book of John chapter 13, how the Lord Jesus Christ practically demonstrated this by washing the disciples' feet. So ministry is not just preaching. It means serving others. And Jesus, in this context, in Matthew 20:20-28, he said, he that will be great among you should be your minister, should be the one that we serve. So ministry is service, serving. And if you go even into the dictionary, you will see one of the definitions of ministering is to serve others, to care, to take care, you know, to show concern, to do something to benefit people. So, take heed to the ministry that you have received of the Lord or in the Lord that to fulfill it. There are three ministries that every saint has received of the Lord if you are born again. The first one is ministry to God. That is your personal intimacy with God, the triune God. Personal intimacy, fellowship, one-on-one. That's the first one, the priority. The second is your ministry to your family. And your wife is number one. And the third is ministering to others. Even as a preacher of the gospel, if you miss this priority, your life and ministry will be destroyed. You cannot put ministering to others ahead of ministering to God, which some are doing, and you will just be a hireling. Neither can you put ministering to others ahead of ministering to your wife. Nor can you put any of them ahead of ministering to God. So if we miss it, we are going to have serious problems. You cannot please God. Your wife is the one that comes after your ministering to God and not after your ministering to other people. And you remember that when Brother Paul was talking about the qualifications of a true minister, a bishop, a preacher, a pastor, an elder, he told us what one of the qualifications is, that he must take care of his family well. He must be a husband of one wife and then be in control of his family. So when it says take heed that to the ministry, it's not just talking about preaching. And so we want to look at that second ministry during this session. Daddy has been talking to us about the first, that is your ministering to God, relationship with God. Now, to look at this ministering to our wives, which is a deep call of God upon every one of us, that can either affect your life or ministry negatively if we fail. We want to share from the experiences of our brethren that are up here. I know that all of us, when we got married, you had your expectations, things you thought you were going to meet with in marriage. And usually, we think that marriage is to minister to us. That is your spouse. You are getting married to be ministered to. That's what many of us thought marriage is. At least you will not continue to cook, or find what we eat. Have you ever come? If you've been eating bread and gari, you say bye bye to gari. At least now I'm married, so my wife will cook for me, and so on and so forth. But sometimes we get into marriage and we discover that it's not like that. It doesn't work out the way we thought. Some men, women will think, once I get married, yata, no more suffering. So in marriage, we discover that things might not be the way we thought it would be. So I want to ask from my brother, J.O.S. Adeboye. Tonight we want to limit our discussion to physical, emotional, social aspect of our ministry. And by the grace of God, tomorrow we will look at the spiritual aspect. So I want to ask for my brother Adeboye, when you got married, what are the challenges, or let me not call them challenges, what are the needs you discover in the life of your wife that you just must have to arise and meet it? If you don't, if you don't rise up to meet it, things will not go well. Maybe just can share maybe two of such with us, maybe physical needs, you know, and emotional or social needs, like we have said. God bless you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I want to thank Daddy and Mommy for this privilege to be part of this table talk. We thank God for the way God has used them for us tremendously. When we got married, of course, as we have had a lot of expectations, we are trusting God for so many things. But as we come together, we discover that there are a lot of things, a lot of needs to be met. That if those things are not done, it will affect the marriage, you know, seriously. The first area I want to talk about, because we come from different background, she doesn't attend this place before. The first area is that our focus, especially where she came back, I mean where she came from, their focus is more on deliverance. They do a lot of deliverance. And I know the implication, the consequences, with little understanding of the Word of God. There was, you know, the Word of God is maybe not well taught. And I felt, and I know that there will be a lot of problem if something is not done about refocusing her to the Word of God. Where I was brought up, you know, attention is given to the Word of God. We are taught the Word of God. We are encouraged to study the Word of God. So that is where we first of all started. I have to begin to tell her importance of the Word of God, how the Word of God can even make her to be effective in those areas. And for me, I have a lot of time for the Word of God. I can read 12 chapters in a day. I read, you know, when I wake up in the night, I read the Bible. In my office, when I'm less busy, I'm always with the Bible 24 hours. So I just discovered that something must be done in that area. So I started sharing with her importance of the Word of God so that she can also be effective in that area, especially where she had orientation. And that's how we started. But the joy of it today is by the grace of God today, we are competing, reading the Bible together.
Hallelujah. Put your hands together for Jesus Christ.
Amen. We do guides to reading a Bible in a year. And we are always, you know, competing. Which chapter now, we begin to share every day our experiences. And we ask questions from one another. So what am I trying to say now? Our Bible study life has changed tremendously.
Amen.
It has affected our growth spiritually. She wake up in the morning, kneeling down, reading her Bible. Before she sleeps, she reads Bible. And our understanding of the Word of God has increased tremendously. In fact, I can say without mixing words that she's addicted to the Word of God right now.
Hallelujah.
So that's the first area that I noticed. And God really helped us. The second area I noticed is that she came from a family whereby they like a lot of ceremonies. Ceremony here and there, ceremony every time. And they always wanted us to be in all these functions. And apart from that, she does a lot of traveling. Even as a student, she would travel to Lagos to go and do, you know, a lot of buying and selling. And I know that the work we do required a lot of attention. It's not what a single person can do. So we have to sit down again and talk that one over. That look, we have a lot of things to attend to. If you are to attend to ceremony here and there, we will not be able to focus. So that's another important area that I thought we may also be having problem, especially in our early marriage. But I thank God today that God has also helped us in addressing that area. I remember there was one of the sisters that sent her to me that, tell your husband that as you have your husband's house, you also have your father's house. We are okay. So we have to sit down and settle that one, address that one, that look, this assignment God has given to us, there is a need for us to stay focused so that we can be fruitful, so that we can be effective. If we start running up and down, attending ceremony here and there, you know, for me, for a whole year, I may not travel out of maybe Ilorin that time because there's always program. A whole year, there's no weekend, we don't have program. And thank God for God. God has helped her in that area. And we are always together. We travel together. We pray together. We minister together. And so on and so forth. So God has also helped us in that area. And we return all the glory to the Almighty God.
Amen. Please, before you leave that, how did God help you to help her to reduce attending ceremonies and travelings?
Thank you very much, ma'am. What we did was to sit down, you know, and discuss what is the effect of traveling, attending function, and then leaving so many things at home. For example, we have a lot of assignments which we need to do as ministers, a lot of work at home. Traveling, leaving the entire work, you know, for me, taking care of the children, I felt it's not going to be so easy like that. So I have to sit her down and say, look, we have to plan all these things. Let us agree when we shall be visiting your people. That's one way we solved it. And then we agree that, okay, twice in a year, in January, we'll visit them by the grace of God, and then maybe in the middle of the year. So that was one way we address that problem, that we can agree to visit them twice in a year. If they have functions, we also attend, especially if it does not clash with church program. The second thing we did was to tell them that, look, let them know when they are planning their program, we already have church program, especially headquarters program, which we must not miss. So please just get them informed, since they are also Christian, that look, this is when we have our program, when we have functions, they should please carry us along so that it will not clash with our program. And so that's the three ways by which we're able to address that problem. And since that time, we have not been having problem. The parents too, the sisters too, they understood with us, and we are flowing together without any problem. I'm sure today we are still the best of friends, you know, to the extended family members.
Put your hands together for Jesus. Praise the Lord. We thank God for that sharing. You know, being a pastor, they cannot but talk about ministry when they are sharing. So, the first thing that our brother has brought to us is the differences in that they came to encounter when they got married. And the first difference was in the area of upbringing, spiritual upbringing. The background of the wife was different from his own. You know, that's sufficient sometimes to cause a break in the home. Say, no, you just must have to stop that. That's nonsense. I will not take that in this house, you know. But look at the way the Lord has helped us to handle it. This is a woman that her upbringing is deliverance. Enemies all over the place, you know. But she's married to a man who knows that the word of God is what brings deliverance. He sent his word and did what? And healed them and delivered them from their oppressions. You know, there are a lot of ministries that the focus is on prayer. If we never get good result. We were in it before. You can spend 10 hours ministering, casting out demons. They will be going out. You will be excited. I came from India. You know, the demons will be speaking. And you are charging them. And you are excited as they are going out and screaming. But come next week, the same people will come back again. The demons are back. If you don't teach them the word, they will never be free. And that's why people visit mountains over mountains. Their problems are never solved. So, but look at somebody now. He knows the importance of the word. She knows, she thinks it's prayer. And the husband has to sit her down and say, look, you have, this area is all right too, but the way to be effective, excuse me, how was Jesus casting out demons? A word. Go! And that was it. That turned our ministry around many years ago. Look, why do we have to be sweating? Jesus wasn't sweating when he was, you know, talking to demons. He exercised authority. And then for the saints, you teach them the word, demons will flee. And he taught the wife. He helped the wife to understand the importance of the word of God. Excuse me, brothers, if you are really Christian men, you have a lot of role to play. We already, you know, into the spiritual, you know. Maybe we'll mix them all up. Tomorrow we'll talk more about it. You know, women love to pray a lot. Go to every prayer house. Women full their place. Mountains, they are there. But how much result do they get? Are they even better in your homes? Are their lives better? I remember a man. The wife was complaining that my husband is the devil. Is this the mother is the one that wants to destroy our home? And when we visited this man and discussed with him, we discovered that he wasn't the problem. The man told us, he said, look, my wife goes to church like anything. She attends every vigil. I go with her to every prayer house. But this is, here is my wife. I can't see Christ in her. The marriage was about to break. So we spoke with the man. We pleaded with him. He said she's going to change this and that. We had a program that time, King's Dinner. And we invited this man. Do you know? He came with a wife. And when the altar call was given, he didn't come out. But we visited after the program. And I said, no, I expected you to answer the altar call now. Can't you see that God can change your life? Didn't you hear the testimony? Didn't you hear the word of God? Is it? Ma, I know that I need Jesus. But if this woman, with all that she's doing at home, think that she has Christ. Me too, I have Jesus. If she had gone out, I would have gone out with her. For you to know that even your own life is in danger, if we don't put these women through. They pray a lot, but prayer is not it. The word, faith in what Jesus has wrought, many of them don't know.